So what you see here is a one-to-one reconstruction of a room that is based on a video that was smuggled out of Waziristan. Waziristan was under siege, and 43 seconds of which were smuggled out. We've spent half a year looking at those 43 seconds and built a space from it, and then interrogated that space. And we can see in front of us all the points where shrapnel, where bits of the rocket has hit the wall, and we can see also two areas when there is less fragments in it, and these are the places where people died. Their shadow, the shadow of the blast, is etched on the architecture. Here, in this video, you see the reconstruction of a Syrian prison.
إذا كان هو هدوء وأنتم ممنوع تحكوا بالليل خلينا نحكي مش وقت الغداء كان في أي صوت؟
الأصوات طبعا برعب نحن ليش؟ إذا راح سجان إجا بيقول لك هاي زنزانة فيها حكي بطلع علم بيضرب عرفتك؟
Architecture function as a mnemonic device, that is, as a conduit to memory. Detainees were working together with us and we build architectural models very slowly. And as they were sizing up the room and as they were locating objects within the room and giving the dimensions of floor plates and doors, new recollections that were suppressed by trauma and pain have emerged.
These testimonies are traumatic recollections and are rarely straightforward descriptions of events.
Here what you see is how we synced thousands of images and clips from the Israeli attack on Gaza by looking at clouds. We created the architecture of clouds, and the shape of the clouds allow us to understand which images were taken at what time and from which place. And by ordering all those images, we could tell the story of the day. In this work, you see a 3 years engagement of forensic architecture with a particular community of Bedouins at the northern threshold of the Israeli desert, or the Palestinian desert of the Nakab. In there, that community is being displaced by the state. That village has been destroyed 111 times today and rebuilt 112 times. That resilience is supported by visual evidence that testify for the presence of those people on site, at least since photography was available in the area. We can look at aerial images from the British Air Force, from the Second World War, where you can already see this community in place. And this is compared to contemporary aerial images that we take with kites. Camera connected to kites, and that shows the continuity of inhabitation, the continuity of resistance in this place. Here, what you see in front of you is an investigation that Forensic Architecture has undertaken together with Baltazar Garzon's office, FIBGAR, where we were examining potential violation of human rights and the rights of nature to be protected through what is undoubtedly the greatest environmental disaster in recent history, the forest fires in Indonesia. The forest fires in Indonesia have produced more carbon to the atmosphere than the entire German economy in a year. It's great pollution that they have produced, and we were investigating what caused that and realized that the cultivation of palm oil led farmers, supported by the state, to burn bits of the forest in order to clear it for cultivation. the last piece in this exhibition examines perhaps a stranger category, the human rights of animals, or in particular, the human rights of the orangutan. Within the Indonesian forest fires, dozens and dozens of orangutans were killed. The question is whether the killing constitute murder. And we were following several cases, several legal cases, particularly in Argentina, where apes were receiving human rights and habeas corpus. And that allows us to investigate at the end of the exhibition the very threshold of human rights. So we don't only provide evidence for human rights cases, but ask, what is human right today? What is the relation between human rights and the environment? What is the relationship between human rights and the economy? What is the relation between human rights and new technology, new image capability, and data sources?